Hey friends, it's another episode of Azure Friday. I'm here with Shahrokh Mortazavi. How are you, sir?
Great, thank you.
You are in charge of what? Because you're a big and important person.
I'm not sure about that. But I generally run a few teams like Python team, mm-hmm. Python tools for Visual Studio, Azure Notebooks. We used to do the Azure SDK for Python mm-hmm. that we handed over to the SDK team. And we also did the R in Visual Studio. And most recently, we are the new home for VS Code for Python.
Wow.
So we hired Don Giamani, who is one of the extension authors, and now he works at Microsoft full-time on the extension.
All right. Would you say that that's data science, or it's more than that, though?
It is more than that. It covers the whole spectrum of what Python does, which is anything from scripting to data science to web to IoT, lots of stuff.
Very cool. It's nice to see that Microsoft loves Python.
At last.
So what do you have to show me today?
So today I'm going to talk about Azure Notebooks. So Jupyter Notebooks, think of them as a REPL on steroids. Mm-hmm. It's got code, markdown, interactive graphics, and so on. It was started by Fernando Perez and Brian Granger. And basically, we've turned it into a free service. Azure Notebooks, notebooks in general, are available as part of Azure Machine Learning Studio, as part of HD Insight. And we talked to the big cheeses and said, hey, can we just turn this loose as a free service as well as a thank you to the open source and Python and Jupyter communities?
Wow.
And they said, do it. So now it's a playground for running code, publishing your experiments, teaching, and it's free both for compute and storage.
That's amazing. That's a lot of free compute.
Yes, it is. It's fantastic.
So you go to notebooks.azure.com and anybody can get started.
Anybody. It's for anyone to use. Most of the use currently has been by academics and people who are trying to learn Python or data science. But basically, we see people like Harvard and Cambridge and Stanford and all putting their courses up there mm-hmm. and teaching, and lots of courses on edX as well.
What is it about notebooks and Jupyter notebooks that make them just so great for education? I mean, it mixes code and prose, doesn't it?
Exactly. You know, if you just want to go straight into an IDE, usually have comments in code. Mm-hmm. You don't have much visual cues. And this, you know, imagine Word documents, but with code cells as well. So if you take a typical scientific paper written in PDF, it's not that much different than an old, you know, Egyptian hieroglyphics paper, right? Actually, that had more graphics in it than a lot of papers today. So this combines all those elements to really tell a complete story. And if you want to do, for example, reproducible research, you know, you can just point at the notebook and say, if you don't believe me, go run the notebook, point it at your own data, and check out my claims. So it's fantastic for a lot of scenarios in academia.
It almost seems like Jupyter Notebooks describe the way that Tim Berners-Lee wanted the web to be.
Exactly.
And it's an active, living academic book that is shareable hypermedia.
Exactly. And it's interesting to point out that, like, for given that it's running on Python and underneath of it is the Anaconda distro, like for Azure ML Studio, the front end and like our system, the notebook system, is runs on Linux. Their back end runs on Windows. Nobody knows, nobody cares.
That's cool. So what kind of people are putting these books together and making them available to academia?
So we have people like here, there's a professor at Cambridge University that has put essentially the Engineering 101 course that has taught where Newton used to teach.
Oh, wow.
Right there, and people just can go and learn Python and lots of courses, material on Engineering 101. We have others like O'Reilly that have put their very famous books like Python Data Science Handbook by Jake Vanderplas. The entire book is written as Jupyter Notebooks, and anybody can go in there and clone it and run it, and, you know, I'm just clicking on random chapters of the notebook, and here it is. It happens to be
It looks like a book, but each piece of code can be run.
Is executable. And you don't even have to log in. You can just look at the HTML captures of the notebook, and you're good to go. If you want to go actually run the code, you just log in. You can even edit it, and then tomorrow when you re-log back in, all your edits and changes are there as well.
I noticed at the top of just that you picked just a random chapter, 519 yeah. clones of just that random chapter.
Exactly. It happened to somebody on Hacker News noticed, put it up there, and lots of people descended on it and started cloning it and using it.
Kind of makes you wonder why every language isn't taught in this way.
You know, it's a good question. Like, we see thousands of people from edX courses that Eric Kamlin has put on Azure Notebooks come in, and a lot of them are just learning Python, learning R. Many people are interested in F-sharp, actually, so we have a .NET F-sharp support as well. Mm-hmm. And so it resonates with a lot of people from a teaching perspective, absolutely.
Do I do all of my work in the browser? Are there any other ways that I might write this kind of code?
So you can, Jupyter runs as a client locally. Mm-hmm. This is just happens to be the hosted version. So if you have notebooks locally, you can upload them, you can download them, and so on. And then there's rumors that it's an Electron version of this is coming as well.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Yeah. So should I just give you a quick overview of notebooks, or
Please.
Do you think, okay, all right. So if you create a library, essentially think of it as a repo, you'll have a collection of notebooks and data and whatever you want to put up there. So here I happen to have a notebook created. So and cells can be generally classified as markdown cells or code cells.
Okay.
And when I hit shift enter or click this little run button, this code gets executed, meaning it gets sent to an interpreter of some sort and it sends the result back.
Okay.
So I happen to have a markdown to show this cool Channel 9 logo. You can do math equations using LaTeX. And I'm not going to bother to run these one by one. I'm going to do cell run all below. So anything that was below my current position is going to get executed.
So I get some. Do some create prerequisites that other cells below it depend on?
Exactly. You can have a sequence. You end up going up and down, you know, random sequence, and that's why I'll talk about JupyterLab, which is the follow-on to notebooks that gives you a little bit more random access. So here, you know, you can get beautiful graphs in whatever discipline you might be in. You can also do escapes into shell. So here you see bang, who am I, or print working directory. This gets sent to the whatever shell is. If you happen to be on Windows, it gets to command.exe or PowerShell, whatever you've set up as your shell, or you can run it here on Linux. There's a bunch of magic commands that you can essentially, again, they're interpreted specially and you can get their responses. Here's a collection of them. If you do %%, you can do execute an entire cell by a interpreter. And finally, you know, you can use curl to download data frames and then do some data science and so on. Another cool thing that people use, you were talking about what scenarios people are interested in. We see people turn blogs into complete executable notebooks. So this is a blog that the Cosmos team did, mm-hmm. and it basically points at a read-only database, and you can essentially check out all the key features of Cosmos directly in a notebook without installing anything, and that's the beauty of it, is zero friction to actually get something and learn from it.
That's amazing. It gets to my point of, like, why are we doing this in 2017? Why have we not always had an executable living web with the...
Exactly. I would almost encourage anybody at Microsoft or other places that are writing blogs that have code embedded in them mm-hmm. to consider using Azure Notebooks and just putting them up there and let thousands of people use them, run them, and learn about their product, whether it's Microsoft or somebody else's product. And then we'll do automatically all the machine management, resource management, keeping the machines patched and scaling as thousands of people come in.
This is a slightly orthogonal question, but how do you keep people from abusing this? If I post this on my blog, what if someone decides to mine Bitcoin with Azure Notebooks?
Right. So we do keep an eye on things. You know, we make sure people, there are guards in place to avoid DDoSing. You know, a little bit of, if people did a little bit of, you know, Bitcoin mining and so on, you know, we'll eventually notice and block them. But generally, so far, there hasn't been much abuse to the point that, you know.
So the occasional for loop might go wild, but for the most part, it's handled.
It's been okay, yeah. Another resource to look at is nbviewer.org. Mm-hmm. This is a collection, sort of a repo for thousands and thousands, or let's call it millions at this point. There are 2 million notebooks available just on GitHub alone.
Wow.
And this doesn't count other places. And you know, just like a wealth of high quality notebooks that you can peruse, download, and quick and immediately run it on Azure Notebooks.
But just to be clear, there's the notebook file that you can share, and then there's the notebook when it has a URL on Azure Notebooks or other online Jupyter Notebooks, right?
Right?
So when you say sharing, you're sharing the file.
Yes, you if you're sharing it through Azure Notebooks, there's a URL, like for example, mine. For this discussion today is notebooks.azure.com/smortaz, which is my login, libraries, which is all my collection of libraries, right. Channel 9 chat.
And then within that, there's IPyNB.
Yeah, IPyNB is essentially the notebook format file.
Right.
And it can share either the notebook directly, or you can share the higher level library that contains all of them.
So then if I go to NB Viewer, I can take those notebooks, I could copy them into my own personal library, I could clone them.
Correct.
Share them however I like, and then take those binary files, or those text files rather, and give them a URL.
Exactly. Yeah, you can have local notebooks that you've uploaded, you can download them, you can share them, you can have private libraries and public libraries. Another O'Reilly book that I should mention is Wes McKinney's Python PyData book, and he is the author of Pandas, which is the standard package you use for manipulating data frames, and it's very, very popular. And last but not least, I'd like to mention that something that might be of interest to you is so what I just clicked on, it just started a Docker container somewhere in Azure on a Linux VM and put me in there. One of the cool features of Jupyter Notebooks, for people that give a lot of talks, is like, you use PowerPoint, which is cool, but it's mostly static. Now imagine if you had PowerPoint, and you could still use like the right, left, up and down, and so on to navigate through. But imagine your PowerPoint executed code.
That's pretty cool. And Rise is the library, is the framework that allows it. Look at that.
So
that's crazy.
So for somebody that gives a lot of talks or webinars and so on, which is, by the way, another very, very popular scenario, is we see a lot of local groups or people that give talks at conferences. Mm-hmm. Suddenly, like 1,000 people or hundreds of people come in, and they're listening to it. And generally, you spend half an hour just setting up your 200 students and says, oh, this didn't install, that didn't install. All of that goes away.
Yeah. People could use an iPad or Chromebook.
Exactly. You just give them a URL. They click on it. They say clone. They have their own copy of your library, and you're good to go.
That's fantastic.
Yeah. Let's see. Do I have any? Yeah, that's it. And then some of the other things, like, you know, some of the more advanced features of notebooks that I was going to get to, let me just do a quick run all for sake of time, is essentially you can have interactive widgets.
I see. So you have a function that you create, and then you make the input have a UI.
Exactly. And, you know, for a little bit more advanced version of them, this is a networks library that I can basically select different algorithms for how the networks is manipulated. And oh, look, who's this guy?
Look at that.
Yeah. So embedding web pages and videos and
YouTube's
so on.
YouTube's
iframe. So for tutorials and webinars and classes given by professors, essentially it's become the ideal canvas. And last but not least, I'd like to point out the next version of Jupyter Notebooks. It's called Jupyter Lab. So Jupyter Lab itself, think about it as...
This looks like an IDE
version
of Jupyter.
Exactly. After a few years of using Jupyter Notebooks alone, which essentially is just this pane over here, people came to the conclusion, look, you need a file manager, much like VS Code and Open Folder and Visual Studio, And then you need to be able to essentially manipulate windows and move things around and play around with them.
Wow.
And it also has a text editor. It's got a launcher that I can go and, you know, have a terminal that I can do all my machinery management. But the good thing here is the editor that you can actually do like VS Code style writing is going to become Monaco.
The code name for the editor that powers VS Code itself.
Exactly. So the rich editor that the VS Code team, the awesome editor that they've built, will become the editor here. And one thing that you probably have noticed by now is like I didn't show you any debugging.
Mm.
Jupyter environment is completely missing a debugger. And the good thing is our team has committed to actually providing the debugger API, the protocol, multilingual. And we're going to do the first implementation for the Python version. And then other people can clone that and use it for their own languages.
Very cool. Yeah. Well, that is just a taste of the power and the cool stuff that you can do with Azure Notebooks. Thanks so much for sharing.
My pleasure.
You have got to go and check out Azure Notebooks and all the great things that are happening around Python that we learned about here on Azure Friday.